Welcome back to Pattern Recognition. So today we want to talk again about support vector machines, but we want to remember what we learned about the duality and convex optimization and apply it to our support vector machines here. So let's see what we can learn more about support vector machines. So the second part of support vector machines, and we are back to the hard margin problem. So here we see that the SVM can be formulated as the norm squared of our alpha vector. So you remember alpha is essentially the normal vector of our decision boundary. And then we have the constraints, our yi, that are multiplied essentially with the signed distance to the decision boundary. And this minus one needs to be larger or equal to zero because we want to preserve this margin. And in the soft margin case, you remember that we introduced the additional slack variables. So here we had the xi I, and the xi I should help us to move points that were on the wrong side of the decision boundary back to the correct side. And therewith we will then also be able to find solutions in cases where the classes are not linearly separable. And we also need to adjust our constraints to include the xi i's. And we also need to put in an additional constraint with the minus xi I being smaller or equal to zero. Now let's set this up in the Lagrangian. So the solution of the constrained convex optimization problem requires this Lagrangian function. So here you have the normal vector to the power of 2 in a norm. Then you have some mu times the sum over the xi i's. Then we have minus the sum over mu I xi I, and we have minus the sum over our constraints, and this is then employing lambda. So one thing that we can do is this mu xi I, we can essentially map this into a meta parameter, and therefore we then can essentially remove this from the optimization because we choose this as a constant c, and we see that we have the Lagrangian multipliers, the mu I and the lambda I. Now if we go ahead and then compute the partial derivatives of our problem here with respect to our parameter alpha, you see that this is going to give you alpha minus the sum over lambda I, y I, x I, and this needs to be zero. So we can solve this, and this gives us alpha is the sum over lambda I, y I, x I. And this somehow seems familiar, right? We've seen similar update rules already in the case of the perceptron, where we had this yi multiplied with xi as an update step. And here we see now, if we have the sum over the entire training data set, we can essentially map this to our original parameter alpha. So that's a very interesting observation. We are able to express the variable that we're actually looking for in the primal problem completely by the training data set and our Lagrange multipliers. Let's look at some more partial derivatives. Partial derivative of the Lagrangian with respect to alpha 0 is simply going to get minus the sum over lambda I y I needs to be 0, and the next partial derivative is going to be the one with respect to xi I, and this is going to give c minus mu I minus lambda I, and this is required to be 0. So if we now use this in our Lagrangian function, we can see here, this is the Lagrangian function for the hard margin case. Then we can rearrange this a little bit. So you see that I can pull out the alpha from the sum and rearrange the sums a little bit. And here you then see that we essentially get for the second term in the sum that it contains the lambda I y I x I transpose. So this can be replaced with alpha transpose. Then the third element here, this is the sum over the lambda I y I. This needs to be zero. And then we see that we still have the sum over the lambda I's. So we can now essentially write this up as a sum over the lambda I and lambda j, yi, yj, and xi transpose xj plus the sum over the lambda I. So this is also interesting because now in the duo, we don't have the original alpha anymore. So alpha was actually the variable that we were optimizing for in the primal. And here you see that this allows us to rearrange the duo. And in the duo, we do not have the alpha anymore. So we don't even have to work with this infimum and so on. We are able to derive the Lagrange duo function directly from the primal optimization problem. So this is a very interesting observation. Also note that our problem is strictly convex, so we can find a very nice solution here for the duo. So this is then leading us to the following optimization problem, the Lagrange duo problem, where we maximize minus 1 over 2 and then this double sum over the lambdas, the y's and the x's, plus the sum over the lambdas subject to that all the lambdas are greater to zero. And of course, we still have to put in the constraint that the multiplication of the lambda I and yi needs to sum up to 1. So this still has to be fulfilled, although it fell out of the primal equation. This has a couple of benefits that we can see now. So this model can be reformulated using something that is called a kernel, because our training data set only appears in terms of inner products. So we essentially only need to compute the xi transpose xj, and this is an inner product of the two feature vectors. And this is also very interesting because the actual dimensionality of this feature space, we don't care because we just have these inner products. So we can apply this also very efficiently in high dimensional spaces because it doesn't change our complexity that much. Essentially, if we're able to pre-compute all those inner products, then we wouldn't change the complexity for the training process at all because we are able to optimize in this inner kernel, inner product space. So this is actually a pretty cool observation. So for convex optimization problems with differentiable objective and constraint functions, we know that the duality gap is zero if the KKT conditions are satisfied. And this then allows us also to work with the concept of complementary slackness. And this is particularly interesting for us. You remember, this was this lambda I times fi of x equals to zero. And if we now apply this to our hard margin SVMs, then you can see that we can rearrange this here a little bit. And it essentially means if we have a lambda I that is greater than zero, then the yi alpha transpose xi plus alpha zero minus one is zero. So this means that the respective observation of xi lies exactly on the margin line. So these are essentially the two lines that are one away from the decision boundary. So we have the margin lines on both sides of the decision boundary, but all the points that have a non-zero lambda are points that lie exactly on the decision boundary. Now this then brings us to the notion of support vectors. So you have to understand the Lagrange dual problem, complementary slackness, and everything if you want to explain what support vectors are. Because support vectors are all the observations in the training data set where we then find Lagrangian multipliers that are greater than zero. So this is a very interesting observation. And if you have a question like, what is a support vector in a support vector machine? It sounds like a very easy question, but actually you need to explain all those concepts in order to explain this to somebody, what the notion of a support vector actually is. Now, this is actually cool because we've seen that the normal of our decision boundary can be expressed as the sum over the product of lambda I, y I, and x I. Now, we know that lambda I is going to be zero for all of the observations that are not part of the margin lines of our decision boundary. So this means that essentially at the end of our training process, we have some observations of the lambdas, and the lambdas essentially tell us which vectors we actually need to store in order to describe the decision boundary correctly. So that's also really cool because it intrinsically selects only the relevant vectors from our training data set. And with these relevant vectors, we can then construct the decision boundary. So that's also a super cool observation. So let's go back to our dual representation. We now see that this decision boundary can be rewritten only as the actual use of the support vectors. So we have the sum over the lambda I, y I, x I transpose the new observation x plus some alpha zero. So if we know the support vectors and alpha zero, then we can actually determine the decision boundary using only our support vectors. So this is also really cool. So you see that our feature vectors only appear as inner products in the learning and in the classification phase. So you see that we intrinsically can work with very high dimensional spaces. And this then brings us back to feature transforms, where we right now are only able to describe linear decision boundaries. And this, of course, has serious limitations, because if we have nonlinear separable data, it can't be classified. Or we can work with the slack variables, of course. Then we can, of course, find a solution, but it will still only be linear and it might not be a very good solution. We'll see a couple of examples. And also noisy data can cause problems. So this formulation is dealing with vectorial data only right now. Now, we have seen already the idea that we can map our data into a higher dimensional space. And this is done using a nonlinear feature transform. And then we use a linear classifier. So we use a feature transform where we now go with phi from a dimensionality of D to capital D. And capital D is actually a much higher dimensionality. And now we then have essentially resulting features that are generated with the feature transform phi of xi. And this is, of course, done for our entire training data set. And the resulting feature will then be linearly separable. So let's look into one example. Let's assume that the decision boundary is given by this quadratic function. Then it's quite obvious that this is not a linear decision boundary. But we can rearrange this function, and then we have suddenly a linear decision boundary, because if we use this phi of x, then we can essentially see that our polynomial is linear in the coefficients. And if we had applied this mapping, then we just have an inner product of our vector a and the phi of x. So suddenly we have a linear decision boundary in this high dimensional space. Now you see that this then alters our SVN. We have the decision boundary that is now given as the sum over the lambda I, y I times, and now this inner product using this feature transform plus alpha zero. So the Lagrange dual problem is then given by the following optimization problem. So we maximize our double sum over the lambda I lambda j yi yj and the inner product of the two feature transformed feature vectors plus the sum over all the lambda I. And again, we have these additional constraints as we've seen previously. This is interesting because this essentially now allows us to define something that we call a kernel function. And now if we have a kernel function that is k of x and x prime, then we have essentially the inner product of phi of x and phi of x prime. And we see that with this trick of the kernel, we can essentially construct a lot of different functions that follow this idea. We've already seen the linear one that we essentially had in the derivation. We've seen the trick with the polynomial, where you can then construct this by an inner product of x and x prime plus 1 to the power of k. So k defines the degree of the kernel. You can use radial basis functions. So there you essentially take the 2 norm of the difference of the two vectors and then plug this into something that is e to the power of minus gamma. And you can also work with sigmoid kernels, where you can use, for example, this hyperbolic tangent here. So all of these kernels are feasible and they can be used and essentially be pre-computed. And we will look into a couple of examples in the next video, where we then want to talk about kernels. What we learned here is that the Lagrangian formulation can be done with the hard and soft margin problems. We looked into the Lagrange dual formulation and we introduced this idea of feature transforms, which we will discuss in much more depth in the next video, where we then talk about kernels. Again, I have some further readings for you. Bernhard Schulkopf's and Alex Smolar's Learning with Kernels, Wapnick's fundamental publication, again Boyd and Vandenberge with COMEX optimization, and also the book by Bishop, Pattern Recognition and Machine Learning. Again, I prepared some comprehensive questions for you. So this then already brings us to the end of this video. I hope you liked this small overview of support vector machines and how the convex optimization can help us in finding the dual problem. And with the dual problem, we then found very interesting properties of the primal problem, including the notion of the support vectors. So thank you very much for listening and looking forward to seeing you in the next video. Bye-bye.